Today's clinic is being held for Andhra Pradesh and for Tamil Nadu. However, participants from UP and Delhi are also welcome. And the main language would be English. Last time we had an issue, so it will be basically English this time. I'm Dr. Vikram Vohra, and with me we have got Dr. Manpreet Bhalla, who is a microbiologist from the NRL at NITRD. We have Dr. Munjal as a TB expert from NITRD, and Dr. Ananya, who is at the ART Center of NITRD. Also with us is Dr. Vandana from Share India, and Dr. Manpreet. Dr. Manpreet, I already said, sorry. Okay, and today's expert will be Dr. Sanjeev Gulati, who is the director of nephrology at Fortis Hospital, Delhi. And the case will be presented by Dr. Dharampal, who is a senior medical officer from NRI ART Center, Guntur, Andhra Pradesh. So I would request you all first to fill up the attendance poll. We would just earmark 2 minutes for this poll before we go ahead. Thank you.
Sir, here is a patient, a 43 years old male patient, diagnosed with genital urinary tuberculosis, left kidney, and started 99 dots cat poll for FDC. What is the better line of treatment in this case? We want to discuss with you, sir, and information from the experts. Date of ART registration is 13-8-2010. Initiation is 7-4-2011 at Guntur Medical College Hospital, and the case was transferred afterwards to us. And this case, the TB confirmation was confirmed on 18-6-2018, sir, and date of ATT initiation is 21-6-2018. The type of detected is extrapulmonary TB. The clinical diagnosis and microbiologically included. And the left kidney is involved. The other details is patient on ART since April 2011 with more than 95% adherence. Initiated on ART with ZLN, switched to ZLE. June 2018, because the patient is an ATT diagnosed to urogenital tuberculosis. Patient has fever, left plant pain, and suprapubic pain, red UOP, and frequency of micturition, hematuria, pyuria, urgency is present. Tender epididymis and thickened vas deferens, swelling of the left testicle is present. After administering ATT and other drugs, the pain is subsided. He was diagnosed as extrapulmonary TB and put on CAT-1. CT scan of KUB, tuberculosis of the left kidney and urinary bladder, Mantos test is positive, 25 mm injurations, and patient was kept on ATT regime for 5 pills per day as per his weight 70 kg. No past test of cough and expectoration, jaundice, chest pain, dyspnea, syncopal attacks and palpitation, etc. No diabetic history, no diabetes, TB, asthma and hypertension. CD4 count at ART initiation is 417-13-8-2010. But last 3 CDL4 counts in CD4 is 347-23-5-2017, CD4-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2-2- creatinine levels is 1.4 milligrams per dilution. Bilirubin is 1.1 milligrams per dilution. Urea is 37 milligrams per dilution. Hemoglobin is 11.2 grams per dilution. VDRL is non-reactive. Alkaline phosphatase is 137. Module test is positive. And hepatitis B and C is also negative. VDRL is also negative. And the module test is positive. CB0 test is also detected. Very low bacteria. But no rifampicin resistance is present. X-ray of the chest shows well-defined radio-opaque densities in the right upper zone, possible calcified granulomas and bone islands. And the abdomen scan shows tuberculosis of the left kidney and urinary bladder, now showing cavities with parenchymal thinning in the left kidney. And a CT scan of the KUB shows kidney, multiple cavity lesions involving the upper and mid-core parenchyma of the left kidney with parenchymal thinning. Left ureter is straightened and appears pipeline with no obvious curvatures. This wall is diffusely thickened from pelvo-ureter junction up to up to vesicoureteric junction. Extensive periuretic fat standing noted. Thickened ureteric wall shows uniform enhancement. New bladder grossly contracted, diffuse extensive wall thickening seen. Minimal perivesical fat standings are noted. No obvious calculus is seen. Impression, these imaging features suggest Cox wall in the left kidney, ureter and urinary bladder. We presume that the bladder may be thimble bladder. And ureter regime started generally, and ATT regime is 99 dots cat 1, and CPT, yes, and other medicines is B6 reduction, and Darlang 15 milligrams only. And can 99 dots 4FDC sufficient in this patient? Suggest the line of treatment in this patient, including the nutrition submission. Sir.
Thank you, Dr. Dharambal, for an excellent presentation. I think we have covered everything. I'll just summarize this entire case. It's a 43-year-old man who had HIV about 8 years since he has been having HIV. He has developed tuberculosis of the renal and the genital areas, and he has been started on ATT for this particular thing. Now, the question which has been put up by Dr. Dharampal is whether we can give anything better than the current treatment regimen, number one. Please correct me, Dr. Dharampal, if I am wrong. And secondly, if the treatment which is being offered to this patient, is it sufficient for the treatment of the disease he has got? Dr. Dharampal, I'll ask you a few questions, if you can just give them. And by that time, if anybody has further questions, they can also add to it. Since the patient has been started, has there been any change of regimen? He's still on 4 drugs?
Yes, sir.
Because it is more than 2 months, and after 2 months, I think we changed the medicines to into the continuation phase. Is the patient still on the intensive phase, or he has been turned to 3 drugs?
The patient is still on CAT 1, sir. After administering the drugs, the epididymal pain and all are relieved, and the patient's suprapubic pain is also relieved. The patient is very well being. Now some problems are relieved. My doubt is whether it is sufficient or to continue or some other additional treatment. That's why I submitted this case for your consideration, sir.
Okay. And second question was whether the patient had any history of tuberculosis in the past?
No history of the past tuberculosis, sir. Because his child was diagnosed, she is dead and she is no more. But history of SLE is there. But in Nizam Orthopedics at Hyderabad, they have given her a tuberculosis treatment, anti-tubercular treatment. But the urologist says that there is not at all a tuberculosis to the girl. But finally, the girl with arthritis, she died off. And his wife is also a small lymph node enlargement is there. But after we restarted the case, but after 1 month, she died at her mother's house due to some family difficulties. So there is no history. But he has gotten some myalgia, he is telling, and used more paracetamol and other things. That is history. He is still more good built. No fever and nothing previously. After suddenly he is telling to me about the pain and the flank pain and some pain at the testicles and other things. Then I examined him, and once again we investigated him with the help of our nodal officer, Dr. Murali Venkateswara, the professor of medicine, and we investigated him thoroughly. And then finally we told him to undergo the CT scan. Finally, he went to our old urologist here who worked previously, and he got it done. And finally, it was concluded that it is a case of urogenital tuberculosis. And we have taken the microbiological, already we have submitted, and we have done that one. Is also CB0 also. That is the basic nucleic acid test. And the urine also, the few basal were seen. Now, after starting the treatment, pain and other things, sir, he was relieved. What he says now, he is somewhat better. But I thought, just your suggestion, sir, still more some other treatment is necessary. And the nutrition, what is supplied, some of the doctors say, ask him to take non-vegetarian, but some doctors say, no non-vegetarian like this. So I want to clarify from you, sir.
Okay, Dr. Ramba, thank you. I think Dr. Gulati will be dealing with mainly a large number of your questions in this particular case. Before we go ahead, I would like to request everybody to kindly participate in this particular poll, which is the pre-test topic, before we switch over to Dr. Gulati for his talk. please do it within next 3 minutes. Now, if anybody has any question to ask Dr. Dharampal, kindly raise your hand so that we can put it up before we proceed on to the talk by Dr. Gulati.
I'd like to thank Dr. Vandana and Dr. Munjal for giving me this opportunity to interact with you. It was a very interesting case that Dr. Dharampal presented. I will give you my perspective of renal tuberculosis as a person who has been looking at kidney disease over the last 25 years or so. Now, renal tuberculosis is a type of extra pulmonary tuberculosis, we all know, that affects the kidney. And it is seen in about 20%. Am I audible?
Yes, Dr. Gulati, you are audible. I will request everybody who is not talking to please close and mute down their mics. Thank you.
So about 20-30% of it accounts for 20-30% of extra pulmonary infection, and it's the second most frequent form of non-pulmonary tuberculosis. It represents a subset of genitourinary tuberculosis. It is usually seen in young to middle-aged adults. Uncommon in children, but not unknown. Causative organism by far is Mycobacterium tuberculosis, but we have seen cases with Mycobacterium bovis also. And there has been a resurgence now in developing countries like ours. And the three main reasons are, one is HIV infection, as was the index case that was presented today. Second subset is the diabetic patients. And the third one is the frequent use of immunosuppressants following organ transplantation. And in my practice, we are seeing all three of them because we have transplanted a significant number of HIV patients with end-stage kidney disease who required a kidney transplant. And diabetics is, we are the diabetic capital of the world, and diabetic kidney disease is the commonest cause of end-stage kidney disease. And obviously, following organ transplantation, the prevalence of tuberculosis is roughly in the range of 10-12%. Our studies from Sanjay Gandhi PGI, when I was there as a faculty, have shown this. So this is a pictorial representation of the healthy kidney. And this is what happens into a kidney which is affected by tuberculosis. You can see there is, it is a form of miliary to, gross nodular transformation that happens on the external surface. Now, clinical features are, mind you, are very non-specific. This patient could present with dysuria. We've all read about how tuberculosis is a common cause of sterile pyuria since our medical college days. Back pain, flank pain, abdominal pain. Microscopic or macroscopic hematuria in my practice is one of the, especially in the presence of sterile urine culture, is a very important lead to an underlying tuberculosis and constitutional symptoms. But a large number of these patients, especially diabetics, they do not develop these, come up with these symptoms also. So you need to have a high index of suspicion. Now, how does tuberculosis affect the kidney? Well, it's very simple. It occurs through hematogenous spread. Kidney is a vascular organ. It is full of larger, medium-sized, smaller-sized blood vessels to capillaries. So they arise from the capillaries within and adjacent to the glomeruli. These cortical granulomas remain dominant until unknown factors permit. We don't know why the bacteria start proliferating. And if the enlarging granuloma ruptures, it delivers organisms into the proximal tubule and thereafter into the urine, which is what we pick up when we look for urine EMB. Bacilli in the nephron are trapped at the level of the loop of Henle, where they multiply and survive well, possibly on account of impaired phagocytosis, because there's a hypertonic environment here. That's the reason the kidney is a reserve of this bacilli. Now, clinically important renal tuberculosis is therefore usually localized to the medulla. So we have if you go back to your pathology days, kidney has a cortex and the medulla, and it is the medullary area, in contrast to most other diseases which originate in the cortex and the glomerular diseases. Tuberculosis originates in the medulla, and quite often it is unilateral. But once there is progressive destruction, there is cavity formation, then you develop overt papillary necrosis. Occasionally, you can get tuberculous pyonephrosis in an advanced stage of disease. Communication with the collecting system usually is responsible for spread of bacilli to the renal pelvis, ureters and bladder, and lymphatic spread to contagious structures also occurs. So there is a direct hematogenous seeding of the pelvic genital organs with clinical sparing of the kidney can occasionally occur. Fibrosis accompanies the granulomatous process, infundibular structures and renal pelvic kinking occurs, and these patients can develop obstructive uropathy. End stage kidney is actually non-functional, gets into a stage of autonephrectomy, destroyed by the combined necrotizing and obstructive processes. So these are the pathological changes of renal tuberculosis. So this is the kidney, this is the ureter, this is the pelvis, this is the papillaries. So there is, as you can see, a central papillary necrosis. Then there is, you can have a fornicial papillary necrosis. Then you can have a deep calyceal cuff formation, papillitis, classic is seen in IVPs. Then you can you develop a moth-eaten calyx, parenchymal calcification, an abscess formation, and then rupture of this abscess if it communicates into the calyx, and thereafter, you know, it's it can be transmitted to the bladder. These are cortical abscesses rupturing into the perinephric space also. Then you can get a pseudo-calculi-like appearance. You can also get an amputated calyx also, which is a cutoff. In advanced stages, you can see asymmetric hydrocalcinosis. There is a scarred pelvis that happens, which is perhaps so seen in the index case, I think. And there is urothelial thickening that is going on in these patients. Continuing on with the clinical spectrum, you could have an infundibular stenosis with calictrasis, calical dilatation. You could have a hiked up pelvis-like appearance, and you could also have a cortical scar. There is urothelial thickening. You could have a ureteral stricture out here. Then you have lobar calcification, and you could have a putty kidney, as we call it, or you could also have a diffuse miliary tuberculosis. So essentially, there is a wide variety of presentations as far as renal tuberculosis is concerned. So coming back to the, if you do a kidney biopsy, this is what you see, which is a caseating granuloma. There is also bilateral microscopic renal involvement is the rule in most of these patients. If you look at, this is the renal biopsy specimen of a patient with tuberculosis showing actually the acid fast bacilli here. Not an uncommon, but one of our patients who following transplant, we did a kidney biopsy. He had actually tuberculous pyelonephritis. So this is a pathology specimen you must have seen during your MBBS days of end-stage renal tuberculosis, basis for the lobar caseation, as you can see all here, the white lobar kidney. So the clinical features, coming back as to, it is an insidious mode of presentation with about 20% of these cases only at operation or autopsy. I still remember my time at PGI Chandigarh, which we had a very good autopsy rate, and tuberculosis was one of the commonest infections, followed by fungal infections that we used to pick up at in our CPCs. So a high index of suspicion enables early diagnosis. One measure of the frequently occurred nature of unitract tuberculosis comes from this Latimer's report, which was published in NEJM way back in 1965. In which 18 of the 25 physicians with renal tuberculosis being diagnosed only with far advanced cavitary disease had developed. So even amongst physicians, you can see that the disease progresses well, and it is very insidious. So high index of suspicion is required. Now, what are the risk factors? When you suspect that there is renal tuberculosis, if there has been a close contact with sputum positive individuals, vagrancies, social deprivation, malnutrition, neglect. In my practice, immunosuppression is a very important component in our transplant patients. We often see that there is a reactivation, there is a spread to the kidney. HIV, diabetes, renal failure is a less important cause alone. But if you have diabetic kidney disease, then it's far more common. Elderly, and obviously if you have patients with TB elsewhere, then these are these patients you would closely suspect or monitor or investigate for tuberculosis. Now, patients with renal tuberculosis may not suffer from any symptoms. That's the first take-home message I'd like for you all to remember. But if you see, clinical features could include presence of protein or pus in the urine on testing, which again, as you know, can be seen in a lot of kidney diseases. More importantly, absence of bacteria on testing urine, presence of blood in the urine, failure to respond to antibiotics. These patients could have reduced kidney function, and if you have excluded other causes, then certainly, especially if it's unilateral, the kidney function is reduced, then suspect of tuberculosis. Increased frequency of passing urine, feeling of burning, getting up frequently at night, that is nocturia when the lower urinary tract is involved, and especially if the urine cultures are repeatedly negative. Symptoms of lung tuberculosis may also be present, which may also include fever, night sweats, and productive cough. Now, what are the complications? So there is a dystrophic calcification, calcium deposits in the kidney, which indicates a progressive deterioration of kidney function. Once there is interstitial fibrosis, these patients develop hypertension. There is development of cellular changes called keratinizing or squamous metaplasia, which may predispose to also squamous cell carcinoma. Abscess formation that spreads around the kidney, as I showed you in some of these initial slides. Extension of the tuberculosis to the ureters and tubes that carries the urine from the kidney to the bladder, especially if it's unilateral and at multiple levels, that is a high index of, you know, suspicion of underlying tuberculosis. Once the bladder becomes involved, it becomes small and contracted because of the fibrosis, and we call it a thimble bladder. Then at the same time, because of the involvement of the ureters or the ureteric strictures or even a urethral strictures, you could get hydronephrosis. But classically what we see is unilateral and multiple levels. So there could be a pelvic ileal system dilatation, there could be involvement of the calluses, and at the same time we are seeing involvement of the ureters also or on the bladder, then, and the other kidney is healthy, then certainly suspect tuberculosis. How do you diagnose? Well, it's similar, the general principles are similar. You can do blood tests, urine tests, tuberculin skin tests, as we have seen today. I would also like to take this opportunity just to remind you that today we don't consider serum creatinine as the gold standard for diagnosing kidney disease. We always rely on eGFRs. It's a very simple method. You can download these eGFR calculators, and all you need to feed in is the age of the patient and the serum creatinine, gender and the race, which is non-American, and you get the estimated glomerular filtration rate, which is very important for your drug dosing. So do calculate the eGFRs. Imaging, CT scan has by and large superseded, you know, CT urography has superseded intravenous urography. Retrograde pyelography is still of help whenever we are suspecting lower tract obstruction. Plain radiographs of the x-ray of the chest, spine, KUB are very adjunctive, useful measures. Ultrasound, I think, is important as an initial screening investigation, and then you have MRI and arteriography in specific patients. So what are the radiographic features? Usually the collecting system is involved, either in isolation or in combination with the parenchyma, and appearances may vary according to the stage of the disease. The earliest sign, as I showed you in the first few slides, is usually papillary necrosis, either single or multiple, resulting in uneven collectors, which is actually almost a hallmark for renal tuberculosis. Then you could develop progressive involvement, multiple strictures, and hydronephrosis. And if you are seeing a combination of the two, you can actually, on a unilateral hydronephrosis along with papillary necrosis, in our country, the commonest cause is renal tuberculosis. Mural thickening and enhancement of cross-sectional imaging may be seen, and progressive hydronephrosis, parenchymal thinning, and even dystrophic calcification in an end-stage kidney. Plain films, obviously, we are looking for calcification, which may be seen in as many as, you know, 25% to 45% of these patients at different stages of disease. It is triangular in papillary necrosis, and you could have focal or amorphous calcification, we call it, on one side of the kidney, and it's called putty kidney or end-stage kidney disease. This is a plain radiograph showing the classical lobar pattern of calcification, which is pathognomic. And as you can see, the other kidney, at least on the plain X-ray radiograph appears uninvolved, and an ultrasound will tell you that there is nothing else out here, and CT would confirm that. So a unilateral disease is actually a hallmark of renal tuberculosis. And if you see very carefully out here, you can also discern some amount of calcifications in the ureter. Fluoroscopy, at least during my time, when me and Dr. Munjal used to work in LNJP, we depended a lot on fluoroscopy and IVP. This is a traditional film. IVP film is quite sensitive to renal tuberculosis, with only 10% of these patients affecting normal imaging. Features to look on IVP are parenchymal scars, multiple calyces, irregular calyces, phantom calyx, hydronephrosis. Lower tract classical signs are Kerr King, sawtooth ureter, pipe stem ureter, beaded or corkscrew ureter, thimble bladder. Mind you, in a contrast CT, all these are equally valid, and to save time and for better information, we do a contrast CT now. This is a retrograde pylogram, still very useful investigation today in today's era to find out what is the level of obstruction. And this shows that if you find hydronephrosis, you're not finding and you're suspecting obstruction in the lower tract, then a retrograde pylogram would be one of the ways, especially if you want to look at the bladder. But at the same time, if you look at the kidney here, you can see that the upper calyx is stenotic here, with a shunt papillary necrosis is there, and the adjacent calyx is fibrous and distorted as well. This is a collimated image from the intravenous uterography that demonstrates multiple cavities. This is an intravenous urogram showing us the classical lobar pattern of calcification in the non-functioning right kidney. The left kidney, as you can see, there is some amount of cupping here, suggesting some early involvement, but by and large it's okay. These are again IVP films showing lower infundibular and renal pelvic scarring here. This shows the papillary necrosis, which I showed you in the, again, the cartoons that I demonstrated in my third slide. And this is the intravenous urogram showing multiple parenchymal cavities with areas of papillary necrosis in the upper calyces. This is a calyceal outline which is distorted here by the adjacent granulomatous tissue that is there. Ultrasound, so sonographic appearances are non-specific and variable depending on the stage of the disease. Early stage, there is a normal kidney or focal arterial, focal cortical lesions with poorly defined border. Progressive, there is papillary destruction with echogenic masses near calyces, distorted renal parenchyma, irregular hypoechoic masses connecting to the collecting system, mucosal thickening, a small fibrotic, thick-walled bladder, echogenic foci or calcification in the bladder wall near the ureteric orifice, and localized or general pyonephrosis. So it's a very good initial screening modality. End stage, you might see a unilateral small shrunken kidney with a paper-thin cortex and dense dystrophic calcifications and may resemble chronic renal disease, except that in most patients with end-stage kidney disease or chronic renal failure, we see bilateral involvement. If you see unilateral involvement, as I've been repeatedly emphasizing, always think of tuberculosis. So this, I picked up some ultrasound pictures showing tuberculosis granulomas here of variable size. This is the ultrasound revealing larger granulomas highlighted by the vascular, the Doppler imaging is there. So there is a cutoff here that is, as you can see, because of the granulomas. This is an ultrasound image revealing a xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis. Like this is an enlarged kidney. So normal kidney is anywhere between on an ultrasound 9 to 10.5. But if you see a kidney which is 11, 12 centimeters and then giving you this kind of appearance, then certainly think of renal tuberculosis. This is an ultrasound image revealing a caseating tuberculosis granuloma communicating with a narrow tract here. This is an ultrasound, again, picture showing a large, thick-walled caseating tuberculosis cavity. Yeah. Communicating with the upper calyx, smaller granulomas are seen elsewhere. So cavity communicating with the calyx, you can bet your money again that it's renal tuberculosis. CT, no wonder, has become very popular. It is the most sensitive a modality for visualizing renal calcifications, and CT-IVP is most sensitive at identifying all manifestations of renal tuberculosis. So if you want to do one test after an ultrasound into the CT, and early on you can see papillary necrosis, as I said, single or multiple resulting in uneven calyptasis. Progressive, there is multifocal strictures, can affect any part of the calyceal system, showing generalized or focal hydronephrosis, mural thickening and enhancement, poorly enhancing renal parenchyma either due to direct involvement or due to hydronephrosis. An end stage is progressive hydronephrosis resulting in back pressure, renal damage, thinning of the parenchyma, mimicking multiple thin walled cysts. Amorphous dystrophic calcification eventually involves the entire kidney known as the putty kidney. I showed you the pathology specimen also. So this is the CT picture. As you can see, these are the two kidneys here, and this shows the dilated calyces, thin walled calyces with calcifications in both the kidneys. This is a CT showing a caseous tuberculous cavity at the upper pole of the left kidney. This is the, again, as you can see, the in the coronal section there, cavity is there. The right kidney, as you can appreciate here, is non-functioning with the scarred renal pelvis, which is seen in a delayed scan. This is the MRI, fat saturated T2W FSCC sequencing, showing multiple small hyper-intense granulomas in the right kidney. Left kidney shows here calyctasis, and this is due to caseous internal debris. Renal angiography shows no specific vascular changes in renal tuberculosis. The vessels appear normal in the early case, while in the more advanced case, there may be zones of irregularity, even complete occlusion. In instances of tuberculous pyonephrosis, angiography reveals the appearance of hydronephrosis. Angiography is of greater help in determining how much viable renal tissue remains and in planning for partial nephrectomy, that is the specific diagnosis of tuberculosis. Another useful investigation in this setting is a DTPS scan now, which we are using commonly in our practice. Treatment principles are similar. Our four-drug regimen for 2 months, as was done in the index case. In our transplant patients, mind you, the rifampicin interacts with our immunosuppression. So we avoid rifampicin, and we have used rifabutin selectively in these kind of patients, but because rifampicin would lower the tacrolimus levels. So that's why you would require very high doses. So we avoid rifampicin in our transplant patients. Surgical methods like partial or total nephrectomy, where the damaged or non-functional kidney is removed. So these are the guidelines, monitoring three cultures, and as was being discussed in the index case, if after you've completed 2 months of therapy, one would do urine cultures before you step down to a maintenance course here, especially in a setting of diabetes or retrovirus therapy or transplant. And just some case reports I would like to share. Tuberculosis is uncommon in children, but not unknown, especially in our country. This is a 9-month-old girl with prenatal diagnosis of bilateral hydronephrosis, and who underwent detailed studies in view of the presumed diagnosis of right functional annulment, right laparoscopic nephroureterectomy was performed. We never thought it would be tuberculosis, but the anatomic, the pathology specimen was suggestive of tuberculosis without previous contact with the disease. This postoperatively, the child was managed with ATT, and the follow-up test revealed improvement of hydroureterectomy of the left kidney. This is a filling cystography that demonstrated the zygourethral reflux, and he did not, as you can see, IVP did not disclose any further findings. This is a reflux right up here. This is a diuretic renogram which revealed an important difference in kidney function. The right kidney was accounting only for 6%, left kidney for almost most of the 94%. There's another patient, overseas patient, who was retrovirus positive, 67-year-old male, her abdominal pain, constipation had come, had a kidney transplant, revealed the clinical examination revealed a left abdomen, hard elastic and fixed mass with an irregular margins, longitudinal diameter of 30 centimeters. There was neutrophilia, the renal insufficiency was there, serum creatinine levels were high. A CT scan with contrast showed the presence of an intraperitoneal mass of renal origin in the native kidneys. And there was a huge post-tuberculosis chalk kidney. Surgery was done, put on therapy, and then thereafter discharge. So this is the chalk kidney. If there are any questions, I would be happy to take. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gulati, for a very informative and lucid talk on the renal tuberculosis. It was really, I would say, very informative, at least for me. Yes, Dr. Dharampal, yes, your question. Dr. Dharampal, your question, please.
Sir, in this case, how many months we have to continue the same dream tank? One or otherwise, another second line or not? Second question is about the nutrition.
Sorry, please repeat your first question a bit slowly.
Dr. Dharampal, you would have to close your fan. Your fan which is in the room is causing disturbance in the audio. Okay, Dr. Gulati, his question was how long we have to give treatment to this patient who is on for the combination of surgery, and whether he would require a second line treatment. The second line treatment we normally reserve for MDR-TB patients. Am I correct, Dr. Dharampal?
Sir.
Okay. Yes, that's the
question. Yeah, so if I remember the history correctly, there was no past history of tuberculosis. The only risk factor was the retroviral therapy. So I think we would start off with the standard four drug therapy for the first 2 months. We would do a urine culture to make sure that there is bacterial eradication, and thereafter step down to a two drug regimen, which in my practice in these immunosuppressed patients, I continue for a year. I would like to know from your experience or what is your opinion about it.
What about the nutrition?
Nutrition.
Non-vegetarian or vegetarian?
Yeah. So nutrition, I think, is a key. We need to give them protein as per the RDA for age. And Indians, by and large, even the so-called non-vegetarian Indians, nobody takes, you know, even up to a gram per kg. Most of us are on, we have done several surveys of are taking only about 0.8 grams per kg. So this has to be actively emphasized that you need to, increase the amount of protein in your diet. No protein restriction, I repeat, even in kidney disease, chronic kidney disease, if there is renal dysfunction, we don't restrict any protein intake. And if you have normal kidney function, then treat him like a normal patient as far as the dietary advice is concerned.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Dr. Mizal, you would like to comment on the queries which have been put up by Dr. Dharampal?
Yeah. If you ask me, we strictly follow our RNTSP guidelines. They are very clear whether the host is immunocompromised or immunocompetent. We'd like to give for 6 months. But as Gulati has told, sometimes we give to a 9 month or 1 year. There's no contraindication that we cannot extend. It depends on the particular case to case. Sometimes we can give up to 9 months or 1 year also if needed. The question which regarding the diet, I fully agree with Dr. Gulati that whatever we use the word of veg or non-veg, we probably say we are non-vegetarian because we hardly take any non-vegetarian. Basically, our diet is still vegetarian. And that one question I would like to ask from Dr. Gulati. Anything you will think twice using streptomycin if you have to use the streptomycin in the case of genital tuberculosis or kidney tuberculosis?
I think it's a very good question, Sushil. So streptomycin is, in a patient, if he's a patient on dialysis, I would not hesitate to use. If it's a patient who's got a kidney transplant, who's on immunosuppression, then it's a nephrotoxic drug. So we, would use it unless and only if you are pushed to the wall. That means you've got a drug sensitivity. And so we would go on to other drugs like moxifloxacin. So there are plenty of other drugs, but yes, if the patient has got normal kidney function, as nowadays we don't rely on a creatinine. That's what I would like to tell the audience here, that if you are thinking of streptomycin and you're starting this patient on streptomycin, please monitor this patient before starting therapy and also during follow-up with the EGFR. So in our lab, if you get a serum creatinine done, you would get an automated EGFR reporting as is done in the West. It is mandatory. But even if your lab is not reporting the EGFR, just download this calculator. It's available for free on the net. And your paramedical staff would also help you. Make sure that these patients have a baseline EGFR. And once this patient is on therapy with streptomycin, you are monitoring the EGFRs periodically.
Okay, before we go ahead, I would like to ask Dr. Manpreet Bhalla, who is the microbiologist at the NRL, that when we have to diagnose renal tuberculosis, what, how do we proceed with the microbiological aspect of the investigations? Because in RNTCP, if we have to do the investigations, what is the sample required, how it is to be taken, how transported, and what the microbiological tests can be done from there. So, Dr. Manpreet, about this particular issue.
Thank you, Dr. Vohra. It was, firstly, I would like to say that it was a very interesting case. And here I see that urine CD-NAC was done. And it has given a valid result. Like it is showing the MTB detected low and if resistant not detected. But as per the RNTCP guidelines and also the kit recommendations, we don't do the CD-NAC on urine samples. The best test, which is as per the program also, we say that it, urine culture should be done. And either we can do a liquid culture. These days, nowadays, we are doing a liquid culture. And the way we collect the samples, we have to, in the guidelines also, even for follow-up, you have to follow up by the urine cultures. As for the collecting the samples, we usually recommend two first morning samples in a sterile container and for on two consecutive days. So this is the...
Okay, so that means you have to take urine, first sample of the day, complete sample of the first voided urine of the day for two consecutive days. And do we give it in two different containers or we mix it together and then give it to the lab?
No, you give it in two separate containers.
Two separate containers to the lab. So that is very important that we give. That is, you see, we are now discussing what is available under our present circumstances, under the RNTCP program. Okay, we'll come back to it later. So under the urine examination, we will go for two samples for 2 days for the microbiological investigation. Anything else?
That's all. Like the only thing I want to say that as we should like we or the program and we don't recommend a CD-NAC for a urine sample. And but in this, if it gives a valid, this has given a valid result, yes. So we can go by it. But otherwise, if like if you get a negative result, we cannot rule out CD-NAC.
Okay. Okay, Dr. Gulati, I had a question. What is the stepwise approach for diagnosis of renal or urogenital tuberculosis? For example, if a person is sitting in the dispensary, I'm talking about a primary health center, and he gets the patient, what would be the approach to the patient so that they can, you can reach a diagnosis of renal tuberculosis? What should be done first and what should be done later? That is the question.
So yeah, first of all, basic plain x-ray chest, an ultrasound abdomen, a urine culture, as was highlighted by Dr. Bhalla, I think that is the pillar, that's the keystone, a urine routine at the same time. Then we would do a kidney function test. So by and large, these were, gamut of investigations. And CBC and ESR, if you have a high ESR, like in all, it's a non-specific way of, you know, suspecting that something wrong is going on. I mean, something odd is there. And if on the ultrasound you do find suspicious lesions, then once you have done a kidney function and you have demonstrated, that's another reason that before you subject this patient to contrast studies, you need to document normal kidney function, because giving contrast in chronic kidney disease patients is fraught with dangers and it can worsen kidney function. So do a EGFR. If the EGFR is normal, then do a contrast CT scan. If the EGFR, if the kidney function is impaired, then we could first do a screening non-contrast CT of the abdomen. If we get useful information, well and good. In this setting, if of impaired renal function, then we use often a retrograde studies, because you know there the whatever the contrast you are giving is limited to the renal pelvis. There is no systemic involvement, spread of the systemic dose of the contrast that is administered. So there, that's why you are sparing the patient from contrast nephropathy.
Okay, thank you. So that would mean that when we are suggesting, we are thinking of urogenital tuberculosis and the patient has to undergo a CT scan, we should refer mainly the patient for a non-contrast CT scan?
So if the kidney functions are normal, then certainly contrast CT scan is the way to go, as I said again. But if there is impaired kidney function, then we should first do a non-contrast CT scan.
Okay. Yes, Dr. Munjal had a question. Dr. Munjal, yes.
This is one very simple question for Dr. Gulati, because when our patients are on ATT or say on ART, when they're undergoing dialysis, the first question they want to ask, should we continue our dose on the first morning dose or should we take after dialysis? Can you highlight on this point?
So I think that's a very good question. And as a principle, all drugs administered for dialysis patients are given at the end of dialysis. Specifically, could be those which are renally excreted. Even others, we say that there may be a minimal excretion by the kidney. So please take the drug on the dialysis day after completion of your dialysis session.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay, anybody having any other question? One more question from my side, Dr. Gulati. Again about ethambutol. Now, ethambutol in tuberculosis, we know that if you have got a renal renal compromise, we tend to either space out or we tend to decrease the dose of ethambutol.
Yes, sir. I think that's an excellent question. Yeah.
So in this particular case, we are having a renal tumor.
Absolutely. Again, another reason to know the eGFR. I still remember when I started my, residency in nephrology way back in 1991. We saw one young child who had chronic kidney disease who had been given ethambutol for tuberculosis in normal doses, and she had developed optic neuritis and she had gone blind. So, ethambutol is one drug which requires dose modification as per eGFR. In end-stage kidney disease also, we do not exceed a dose of 400 milligram per day in contrast to your usual doses.
Yes, Dr. Munjal.
I just want to know, in how many cases of kidney tuberculosis you see impaired eGFR?
If I look at 100 patients with opinion, because it's a referral center,
yeah,
and we see it, we do see about one third of them having bilateral involvement and having impaired kidney function. Mind you, if your one kidney is absolutely healthy, there is only the other kidney is in one single kidney is involved, your serum creatinine would be absolutely normal. It is only once you go do a DTPS scan or you do a contrast CT, you will find a non-functioning kidney. By your kidney screening, you would not be able to pick up
This is very important for us that we should avoid using streptomycin and we should be very careful in using ethambutol in the case of kidney tuberculosis patient.
Absolutely. In today's, we have the National Kidney Foundation guidelines, which have been validated by the Indian Society of Nephrology also, that saying very clearly that if we are looking at kidney function, please do not stop at serum creatinine. I didn't have a slide on that. I should have put it today because of constraint of time. The serum creatinine, mind you, starts increasing once GFR, as we all know, is the gold standard for measuring kidney function. Now, let's say you have normal kidney function, which is anywhere about 120 mL per minute. Now, your kidney function starts decreasing. The GFR starts decreasing from 120 to 100 to 18, 70. So, if a patient has 70 eGFR, glomerular GFR, and you do a serum creatinine, it will be absolutely normal. It is only once the GFR goes below 60 that the serum creatinine starts rising. The urea actually starts rising much later on. It starts rising once the eGFR falls below 40. So they are no longer the gold standard. The gold standard is estimated glomerular filtration rate, and all of us, I want to emphasize, should be measuring EGFRs in our practice.
Thank you, Dr. Gulati, for this information. Yes, from Guntur, Dr. Ramdas desk.
Guntur, NRI Medical College.
I'm yes.
Dr. E. Murali Venkatesh Rao, nodal officer. Thank you, sir. And I'm having one doubt of what is the earliest test to detect the earlier renal tuberculosis?
So the earliest test would be
renal tuberculosis.
Yeah, so the two tests would be a urine culture for mycobacterium in combination with a contrast enhanced CT scan. These two tests would give you the earliest indication for renal tuberculosis.
Specifically to confirm the renal tuberculosis, any test? Earlier?
No, earlier would be again your urine culture, urine for AFB. That would be your the confirmatory test. The
if it is still urine is negative for culture, what okay. We can do?
Well, if you ask theoretically, one could do a biopsy, but that's an invasive test. You know, you could do a kidney biopsy.
Vein sampling is useful.
Sorry.
Renal vein sampling, venous blood sampling is useful.
Renal vein sampling, there are, yes, it's an experimental method, but it's a very, you know, invasive process. What you are saying appears true, you know, if you look at the pathophysiologically, but practically speaking, I think it is a very difficult test to do, even in the best of centers, and it's an invasive test, and so... It's not there in any of the standard guidelines.
Thank you.
Thank you. With this, I would like to go on to the post-test poll. Now, we are already exceeding the time. So, we have got just 1.5 minute for the post-test poll. And during this period, I would like to thank Dr. Gulati for his presence and his sharing his knowledge with us on the ECO platform. I would also like to thank Dr. Munjal, Dr. Vanna, Dr. Manpreet Bhalla, and Dr. Ananya, and all the audience and all the ART centers which have joined us today. Please complete this particular poll in the next 60 seconds before we go on to the last poll of the day, that is the feedback poll. I request everybody to please fill up the feedback before you log off. Thank you all for having attended today the e-NISCHIT clinic. And we will be seeing you the next Thursday. You'll be informed accordingly. Thank you.